The heavens are telling the glory of God, and the firmament proclaims God's handiwork. Good evening, dear brothers and sisters. I am happy to invite you for our Sunday evening worship. This evening, the leader of our worship is Reverend Dr. Shanti Sudha Monika. She is a professor in the Department of New Testament and the Dean for External Studies of Gurukul Lutheran Theological College and Research Institute. Reverend Dr. Shanti Sudha Monika has obtained BD, MTH and Doctorate in New Testament. She is married to Reverend G. Madhukaran, a pastor in the Baptist Church. They are ordained in the Baptist Church. They are blessed with two dear sons, Mr. Nathan Johanan, who has completed his BE, Mr. Aaron Sudarshan, who is in the BSW final year. Now I request Madam to come and lead us in the worship service. Let us quieten ourselves in the presence of God and get ready for the worship.
Greetings to you all in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I thank our chaplain, Reverend Dr. Daniel Kilbraj, for introducing me. Let us spend some moments in silence, acknowledging the presence of God with us. Let us come into God's presence and worship God in spirit and truth. Let us come with our hearts full of thanksgiving and praise. As the psalmist says, "This is the day which the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it."
We praise and thank you, God, for your amazing power and work in our lives. Thank you for your goodness and for your blessings over us. Thank you for the hope you have given us, even through the toughest of times, and strengthening us for your purposes. Thank you, Lord, for your great love and care. Thank you for your mercy and grace. Thank you that you are always with us and will never leave us. Thank you, Lord, for your incredible sacrifice so that we might have freedom and life. Forgive us when we don't thank you enough for who you are, for all that you do, for all that you have given. Help us to set our eyes and our hearts on you afresh. Renew our spirits. Fill us with your peace and joy. We thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you for your word, which is spirit and life. We love you and we need you this day and every day. We give you praise and thanks, for you alone are worthy. In Jesus' name, amen. All come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into God's presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to God with songs of praise. Let us all join together and sing the hymn, "Beautiful Words of Life."
Sing the Let us confess our sins together. God who forgives, we bow our heads before you and we confess that we often forget that we are yours. Sometimes we move on our lives as if you do not exist, and we fail to be a witness to you for which you have placed us on this earth. For we ask your forgiveness and we also ask for your strength. Give us clear minds and open hearts so that we may accept each other and live in harmony with everyone. Forgive us for not heeding to your word, which is spirit and life. Remind us to be who you would have us to be, regardless of what we are doing or who we are with. Hold us to you and build our relationship with you and with those you have given us on earth. Order our lives, Lord. We have too much, consume too much, expect too much. Grant us perspective to see this world through others' eyes, than just our own. Grant us compassion where there is need to play our part and not turn aside. Grant us gratitude for what we have, our daily bread, the gift of life. Order our lives, Lord. Give us simplicity and thankful hearts. Forgive us, Lord, for not acknowledging that your words are spirit and life. Let us receive the assurance of forgiveness. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in loving kindness. God has not dealt with us according to our sins, nor rewarded us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is God's loving kindness towards those who fear God. As far as the east is from the west, so far has God removed our transgressions from us. Amen.
For today's evening Sunday worship, the scripture portion is taken from Genesis chapter 1, verse 1 to 5. Genesis chapter 1, verse 1 to 5. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep. While the wind from God swept over the face of the waters, then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day.
The scripture portion chosen to be read is from John chapter 6, verses 60 to 65. The Gospel according to St. John chapter 6, reading from verse 60. When many of his disciples heard it, they said, "This teaching is difficult. Who can accept it?" But Jesus, being aware that his disciples were complaining about it, said to them, "Does this offend you? Then what if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? It is the Spirit that gives life. The flesh is useless. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. But among you there are some who do not believe." For Jesus knew from the first who were the ones that did not believe and who was the one that would betray him. And he said, "For this reason I have told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted by the Father." Here ends the reading. Praise be to God.
Soi nei to em in tung qua in the
Let us pray. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. The theme for this year, Breathe the Breath of God, has surely provided us a good resource to reflect upon, to provide hope and relief in our present context of distress. Though there is so much of suffering inflicted by the pandemic worldwide on one side, yet we are also able to find hope, trusting in the redemptive healing grace of God, which has so far enabled the entire human community to not only to cope up and adapt with this tragedy, but also to make great efforts for remedy. I would like to submit this reflection under the theme, Logos, the life-giving breath. Logos, the life-giving breath. In John chapter 6, verse 63, the second part, Jesus says, "The words that I have spoken to you are spirit, pneuma, and life." From this verse, this theme has been formulated to envisage an affirming in this worship of Christ, the Logos, as the life-giving spirit. Pneuma is the Greek word for breath and is also used to refer to spirit or soul. Both in the Septuagint and in the New Testament, the term pneuma is used to denote the spirit or ruah, which also means wind. Pneuma in the biblical usage, denoting the spirit, does not mean in its literal sense the physical material of an ether or vapor. Rather, it is used to denote the incomprehensible being of God. In this homily on the title Logos, the life-giving breath or spirit, our reflection will be on the dynamic of how the words of Jesus prevail as spirit and life. For this, we would be viewing three aspects. Firstly, life. Secondly, pneuma, the spirit. And thirdly, with the words of Christ. First, life. The theme of life is central in the Gospel of John, and this is revealed as the author's essential motive, as clearly expressed in his words in John chapter 20, verse 31. I read, "But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in His name. The Jonan understanding of life is one that is further developed on the popular understanding of life in traditional Judaism in the sense of life of the age to come, but also means a mode of existence of enlightened, redeemed life with a divine quality. For John, life is in the very presence of Jesus, and this life is imbibed into humans by faith in His words. It is union with God, not in the mystical sense of the Greek thought, but by the indwelling of the words of Christ. John chapter 5 verse 24 says, "Anyone who hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and does not come under judgment but has passed from death to life." Very consistently throughout the gospel, we find the words of Christ as the active agent in making it possible for humans to receive that life is assured through Christ. Allusions to the Hellenistic concept of life is also seen, because at the very outset in the prologue in John chapter 1, his Christology begins with employing the Greek philosophical concept of logos, which John uses to refer to the Word of God, the self-revelation to humankind. Jesus is the eternal God from the beginning, and in Him was life. Here in John chapter 6, a brief survey reveals a significant theological pattern very typical of John, by which he presents this narrative. The miracle of the feeding of the 5,000 is the setting in which Jesus' discourse of the bread of life is placed. Jesus, as the giver of life through His flesh and blood, is explicitly brought out here in this discourse. It is through His salvific sacrifice of His flesh and blood this life is granted. Chapter 6 of John is also held significant in church's traditions for the sacramental value it accords to the celebration of the Eucharist as a continued life-giving source. "Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, I live because of the Father. So whoever eats me will live because of me." John chapter 6 verses 56 and 57. Here we clearly visualize the meaning of life as elucidated in John's Gospel. It is made possible through the person and the work of Christ, and it is a life in an indwelling union with Christ. Second, we look into pneuma, the Spirit. Pneumatology in John's Gospel presents a developed understanding of the person and work of the Spirit, as much as it is found in the Pauline writings. Beginning from the descension of the Spirit on Jesus in His baptism, in John's Gospel, we also find in chapter 4, God is Spirit, pneuma. This would mean that the essence of God's being is not corporeal in the human sense, but it is based much on the Jewish understanding, which was in contrast to the pagan anthropomorphic concepts of the deities. Jonan's understanding of the Spirit is very much based on Hebrew understanding of the term Ruah, the life-giving breath of God in the creation of humans. God breathed into the nostrils of human the breath of life, and the human became a living soul. In John chapter 3 verse 8, Jesus explains to Nicodemus, comparing the blowing of the wind to the birth of humans by the Spirit. Here, pneuma or the Spirit is invisible and is known only through its sound and its effects. The creative activity of the Spirit is consistently maintained in John's Gospel. The metaphor of living water is employed also in John chapter 4 verse 14 and chapter 7 verses 38 to refer to the Spirit who gives eternal life to those who believe in Christ. In all these narratives, the life-giving nature of the Spirit of God is a prominent theme. John also has the understanding of the Spirit as Parakletos, the Advocate, also known as the Spirit of Truth, who would abide forever. John chapters 14 and 16, the Spirit would guide into all truth, and also the cause of internal regeneration by guiding into conviction of sin, righteousness, and judgment. In John, we can perceive an idea of the Spirit as the continuing presence of Christ after his ascension in chapter 14, verses 18. It is by the indwelling of the Spirit, the life which is promised in Christ is made possible to the believers. The Spirit also engages in the vital activity of bringing the words of Christ into the hearts, which you find in chapter 14, verses 26, thereby making possible the life of union with Christ as promised through Christ. Here also we see the insistent unity between Spirit and the spoken words of Jesus. We see the life assured in by the Spirit into the cognitive realm of human experience. And this is made possible by the breathing in the words of Christ into the person's self. In this way, the divine values of life are imbibed into the nature of the person, which is indeed the qualitative nature of life made possible in Christ. Thirdly, we see the words of Christ as Spirit and life. We now proceed to understand the unity between the words of Jesus with Spirit and life as expressed in John chapter 6, verse 63. The words that I have spoken to you are Spirit and life. Now here in this verse we find both these themes, Spirit and life, are mentioned in unity with the spoken words of Jesus. The interconnectedness between the uttered word of God and the creative life-giving activity of the Spirit is also seen in the creation narrative, where the Ruah, Spirit of God, hovers on the primordial waters in the backdrop of God decreeing God's word for creation. Similar unity is also seen in the vision of Ezekiel when he proclaims the word of God to the dry bones, and a great wind, Ruah, is blown over that valley to revive the dead. The creative life-giving activity of God is seen undertaken in unity between God's Word and Spirit. The Logos is portrayed as a manifestation of the power of God's Word in life and light, which you see in the prologue, that is in John chapter 1 verse 4. The rabbinic sayings also accord such status in declaring the Torah, which is the Word of God, to be life and light to humankind. Such a proposition is a general thought of Judaism, which is also seen in Psalm 19, where glorifying the Torah and the praise of God's glory in creation. And this glory is expressed in the terms of the spoken word. Similarly, here, the spoken words of Jesus are seen as the vehicles of Spirit and life, which are in essence found in his person and work. In regard to the unity of the Spirit of the Word, Martin Luther explains, I quote, Christ binds us solely to his Word. He does not want to see the Holy Spirit divorced from the Word. If we want to find Spirit and life, we must become spiritual and hear the Word of God. This excels reason and rises higher than reason can rise, unquote. All that Christ is in his words, and he is the truth and the life. It is only an affirmation to say that he is the Logos. Origen also emphasized the spiritual meaning of scripture. He conceived that just as a human being is said to be made up of body, soul and spirit, so also is sacred scripture. Therefore, the scripture had three senses: the literal, the moral and the spiritual. A more profound and ultimate sense of the word of God is to be found in the words of Christ. Christ, being the word of God, is the life-giving spirit. Hence, while the Logos of God is the rational content of thought, it is always in some sense uttered, and because it is uttered, it becomes a life-giving power for humankind. Just as the eternal God, Logos, is incarnated into flesh in the person and work of Christ, the life-giving spirit of the Logos is permeated in the words of Jesus. The content of the teachings of Christ and the utterance of it remains now the ongoing source of the life-giving spirit. The words of Christ do also carry the same sacramental efficacy as the continual source of the life-giving spirit. Life is conceived as the most intimate union between God and humankind. It is affected into the realm of humans by sharing of the divine nature, by which the values of the kingdom of God are brought into real practice. It is the spirit who enlivens this rebirth to this life of divine values. Such a transformation is the fruitful consequence proclaimed by the words of Christ. The words of Christ are not a mere set of principles which transfer knowledge of ethical moral values. They are spirit and life, which means that they enliven with the presence of Christ, with his life-giving spirit. Through Christ's sacrificial death and resurrection, humans are bestowed with life and spirit, which is an eternal union with God and also a regeneration of the nature of the person. This is further carried on through the message of Christ as the word of God. The gospel of Christ now continues to breathe the spirit and life of God for those who believe. It is the creative activity of the blowing of the life-giving breath over humans. The ruah which hovered on the primordial waters, the breath which enlivened Adam into a living soul, the great wind which resurrected the dry bones in the valley, the same life-giving breath, the Logos, now blows over humans to give life through the words of Christ. As a theological community, our calling and responsibility will be, therefore, to infuse this breath of life to the dying humanity. Christ's words, the gospel message of love, peace, and justice, ever and always remain the life-giving breath to save the perishing human conditions of moral impurity, social injustice, and every evil human enterprise which threatened to destroy life in its goodness. Christ's message is very much a life-giving breath to the dying, and therefore has to channelize to reach the needy. As a community of stewards of the gospel, there is a great urgency in our role to serve as ventilators, providing the fresh air of hope and relief to choking. Very recently, we heard in our news about the tragic incident in a hospital where there was a power shutdown for a long period. Due to this, three patients in the intensive care unit had passed away. They gasped for breath because the oxygen supply was cut off. The gospel of Christ, its message of redemption, breathes hope and life to human society which is in distress. While the suffering caused by the pandemic is on one side most devastating, The present global situation is reeling more under other destructive forces which seek to wipe out humanity from the face of the earth. Like never before, we hear more in the recent times very strange situations of conflicts and disputes between countries. Even in dealing with the pandemic, an unfortunate disunity and the lack of coordination is prevailing between the so-called developed nations. Several nations are in their verge for calling out for a full-fledged war with neighbors. All this points only to the decay of values of peace and harmony necessary for the coexistence of humankind in this world. The pandemic has revealed the true face of the real condition of the poor and our collective failures in providing relief to the needy and the sick. Most tragic is the news we hear about the exploitation by several commercial hospital establishments in dealing with the sick and dying. Violence against the weak, the crimes in the high places has become a norm. Hatred and enmity are being racked up more on the basis of religion, caste, race, language, gender, and color. Several social scientists are predicting a dangerous collapse of the social order in the world. Drastic climate changes due to the greedy and irresponsible human pursuits threaten to kill the very existence of life on earth. All these destructive forces are on the rise only to choke the human life, to gasp for breath, a struggle to survive. There is a very great agency like never before for the message of the gospel of Christ to this dying humanity. Human history of the past stands witness to the efficacy of the words of Christ in the redemptive and life-giving power, which has transformed individuals and communities into havens of peace and well-being for all. This is the message of Christ with its values of hope, peace, and justice, which still strives to confront the destructive forces of evil within humans. For they are the words of Christ, which are life-giving breath. I would like to end this reflection by saying the prayer of Saint Francis of Assisi, because it surmises the focus of this homily, how the message of Christ's love and peace within us can empower us to be channels of that life-giving breath in this life-stricken world. Prayer of Assisi. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. And where there is sadness, joy. O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, and it's in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it's in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen.
Friends, it is assumed that the pandemic situation of India is going to get its peak during the month of October and November. Let us all be reminded to always be prayerful, careful, and alert, yet not panic. Let us always make sure that we follow the precautions and pray for one another so that we may be able to meet one another soon. Let us pray for the bereaved family and the sick people of our community. Dear Lord, we pray for the family of Mr. Jasper of BD Second Year, who lost their beloved father. Lord, we pray that your comforting presence will be with our dear ones who are undergoing bereavement. May you wipe out their tears and change their tears of sorrow into the joy of feeling the presence of your Holy Spirit in their times of this gravest sorrow. May your spirit strengthen them to go through this valley of the shadow of death. Lord, at this time, we also pray for the family of Mrs. Sharmila, the secretary to the principal of our college, the father of Mr. Rufus, MTH, first year, and Abby Charles, BD2, who are in their bed of sickness. Lord, we pray that they may be touched by the wounded healing hands of Jesus Christ, so that they may recover quickly. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Lord, we pray for the people all over the world who are in distress situation. For the people who are in pain, we ask for your healing upon everyone, for you are a God who heals. Remove hatred and contention from the hearts of men and women in various nations across the world. Let shalom prevail. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We pray for our country and her leaders. Grant them grace and wisdom to lead the country in the right way in the midst of the pandemic situation. Grant them the ability to lead the nations in love towards all men and women. Teach us to esteem and delight in one another. Grant us the ability to love indeed, in truth, in practice, and in sincerity. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, guard us and keep us in perfect and constant peace, for our minds are stayed on you, because we commit ourselves to you. Lord, give us your peace in all what we do. Lord, we pray for that your thoughts and plans for us for peace and well-being may be established on earth. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers.
Grant us the ability as nations to follow after the things which make for peace and things which cause us to build up one another as nations. Lord, may your peace rule in the hearts of women and men all over the world. Let your peace guard over our hearts and minds. May the values of life and liberty truly be our watchwords. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the Gurukul community. Thank you for guiding us in all what we do. We pray for the administration, the principal, the teaching and the non-teaching staff and their families. Grant us your grace and protection. We pray for all the students wherever they are. Be with them and guide them in their ministerial formation. Help them in their academic endeavor. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, at this moment, we pray for all those who have celebrated their birthdays last week. Tumati Nehemiah, BD 3rd. Ebenezer C, BD 3rd. Shanti K, MTH 2nd. Thank you for their life and their providence who have granted them. As they enter a new year, continue to bestow your grace upon them and bless them, and let their lives be a blessing to others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us all sing together hymn, On Christ the Solid Rock I Stand. On Christ the Solid Rock I Stand.
I did not trust the sweetest spirit. shall come with trumpet sound.
Let us look to God in prayer. Thank you, Lord, for being with us all through this worship. Give us the perfect faith to acknowledge and revive the life-giving spirit of your words. Breathe on us the breath of life, that we may be revived to the fullness of life. Strengthen us also to be the channels of your spirit to those who are dying in want of life. Your words are the breath of life. Grant to us that our lives would reflect your words of love, peace, and justice to provide relief in this distress-stricken world, especially in this crisis of pandemic. We pray that the spirit of the gospel of life may take root in us to grow into sources of life for others. We submit ourselves to your protection and guidance. Abide with us all through. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Shall we say the Lord's Prayer together? Our God in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Let us receive the benediction. Let the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with all of us now and forevermore. Amen.